High in the mountains of northern New Mexico, between Santa Fe and Taos, lies a most unique land. These are the villages held in the embrace of La Jicarita Mountain, small enclaves settled by Pueblo Indians and Spanish and Mexican explorers centuries ago. Today, the descendants of settlers, explorers, and indigenous people of southern Taos County live here in harmony with the traditions and customs passed down from generation to generation. A proud people whose roots are deep in the land they love and have a foothold in both the modern world and the history of their rich culture and heritage. These are the people of the Rio Lucio, Chamasal, and many other small villages surrounding Peñasco, New Mexico.
It's a pleasure to be back home. Got back here last Saturday, and I've been enjoying my time here. It's one of those things, once you leave, you miss home. Just to give you a little idea of who I am, I'm the son of George and Melba Maestas, and I graduated from Peñasco High School in 1982, and then moved on to college at New Mexico State, and graduated there with an electrical engineering degree, and eventually moved on to go work for Hughes Aircraft, old Howard Hughes, and his companies. As it turns out, I've been working there the last 30, this is my 30th year working in the aerospace industry. We basically build ground stations for satellite communications, so I've worked on NASA contracts, previously a weather satellite system that now, as you can see on the weather, now we're getting this nice 3D look of the Earth, where you can see the clouds in 3D. And so I've been worked on that project for 12 years. And today I'm now working on the next generation GPS satellite system to basically secure the navigation for our country. Haven't been in the military, but I've supported contracts that make sure that our people are safe on the ground and in the air and at sea. Today, what I'd like to do is basically give you an idea of what our family connections are. The Maestas tree, that's just a small piece of the whole tree. It's just a branch. But along the way, I'll call out different families that we're connected to, and to show the associations. So I'd like to first start out here. Looks like the computer went into sleep mode here for me.
First computer glitch of the day. We're good.
So, let's see. Looks like the Rayo fell asleep, huh? Okay. Oh, you're fine. So,
keep going and
I'll go and continue here. And here's the mouse. So, in terms of siblings, just to give you an idea, I basically put together a family tree that originally was put together for the a family reunion that we had with the Maestases, and this was back in 2004. So I was able to break everything out by my grandfather's family tree, Vidal de Jesus Maestas. And just to give you some sort of reference as to what their legacy is, has become, and still is growing, they have left a legacy of 5 generations, 8 children, 17 grandchildren, 32 great-grandchildren, 20 great-great-grandchildren, and 1 great-great-great-grandchild. And so, as you can see, as time goes by, our families grow. Now, at one point in time, our families were very small, and we're all interconnected here. So, as far as my siblings, I have a sister, Louise, oldest sister, and she's seated back here. My sister, Cecilia, she's also seated next to my mom. My sister, Sophie, she has a booth out here with some banquitos. And a brother, Ramon, who lives in Phoenix, and a brother, James, who lives in Denver. So, Kari, can you get me the mouse? Need some cheese for the mouse, though. So, from a sibling perspective, we're a family of 6. And as that goes on, we also have cousins from my Aunt Lucille, Leyva. Aunt Lucille and Uncle Ed. And we have Loretta Leyva, Patrick, Barbara, Paul, John Paul, he's our priest, one of our priests. He was ordained back in 2000, I want to say. And our other cousin, Leonard. My Aunt Josephine, she lives in Denver and is married to Tom Miller. And their names are Bernadette, Veronica, Tony, and Teresa. So, and of course, I cannot forget my Uncle Herson, who most of you know. They called him Luger, right? And his daughter is Melissa. And their families have grown tremendously. Now, what I also want to point out here is my grandfather was married to Berenice Lopez. She was the daughter of Tomas Lopez there in Rodarte. And through the Lopezes, we're basically tied also to the Rodartes. They're in Rodarte. My tio, or grandpa, I believe it was my tio Franca Rodarte, was responsible for opening up the first post office there in Rodarte, and so they named the town after him since he was the postmaster. And so as you can see, there's many, many ties that we have within Peñasco. But I also want to mention my mom's family, which includes the Tafoyas from Llano and Martinez's from Llano Largo. But also from a Martinez's perspective, my grandfather, his original name was Arguello, which we're also tied to Gerald Arguello, and through the Tramperos. He was adopted early as a child by the Martinez's. Don't know exactly what transpired there, And so as such, we carry the legacy of both families. Now, as we move on to our grandfather's family, you will see that my grandfather was one of, I didn't remember the number, but roughly about 12 children. And so he was a son of Manuel de Atocha and Ninfa Duran. And so that is also our tie to the Duranes, Felix Duran, and some of the other Durans. And so I think Martinez, I want to say Mooch. his grandfather was Duran, right?
Yes.
Manuel
Duran.
Manuel Duran. And so we're all, in addition, looking at my grandfather, his siblings were Elisita Maestas, who was married to a Lujan, or shall I say a Tafoya, but Mary Lujan was her daughter. And they lived here at the a gas station at the Y, where you go to either Rodarte or Vadito. He had a brother named Candido who moved to the Denver area, Colorado. And I might mention with my tio Candido, he and his wife took care of the son of my grandfather. And my grandfather, Vidal Maestas, was also married to Juanita Lopez, who happened to be the aunt of my grandmother. And she passed away during childbirth. And as it turned out, that my tio Candido and tia Berenice took care of the little baby, and I understand the baby passed away. So, and they lived up in Llano de San Juan. There's a sister Teresina, a brother Ramon that lived in Taos, right there in the ranchos of Taos. My tio Juan de Jesus, he's my padrino, and he and his wife Corina Duran, Corina, I forget Trujillo, lived in Llano de San Juan, and they were also cattle ranchers. Now, that's interesting from a ranching perspective. My tio Juan and Grandpa Vidal were always in the mountains because they grazed these lands as their fathers did, and forefathers. There were times that we would go, you know, my grandfather would come up, Grandpa would come up in his green truck. He had this Ford, it was a Chevy or a Ford flatbed truck, and he had the barandales, and he had these two horses, Ginger and Dad, do you remember Grace? No. Yeah, Grace was one of those horses that the moment you tried to jump on her, she would try to meterte en miedo. She would try to kick you. And if you showed some sign of intimidation, she owned you. And so she wouldn't move. And it was one of the only people I knew that could move it was my make her move or run was my cousin Tony from Colorado. Mm-hmm. He knew how to handle her. So it was one of With them, we used to go clean ditches. We used to, go irrigate. We spent long hours. There was a situation where I went up with my grandpa to go look for the cattle, he basically, before he would leave, he would have his 6 eggs and meat, and he would have his lunch. And we just didn't know that we needed to eat well before going up. Sometimes they'd pack us they'd pack us our lunch, but because he had eaten so much, he was just driven, and before you know it, it's already 4 o'clock, and you had missed lunch. You know, I may be exaggerating because I'm trying to remember off the cuff of my brain right now, but it's, you know, I also remember a situation where he told us, make sure you bring your Snicker. Okay. Yeah, okay, Grandpa. And so we kind of dismissed it, but as we were up there, and all of a sudden, middle of June, July, the clouds ruptured and it was raining. He'd look at you, did you bring get your Snicker? Well, we knew what a Snicker was after we were drenched. It was a slicker. No, you know, one of those yellow raincoats? Yeah, so after a while you learn you need to eat well, you know, prepare well, but between he and my Tio Juan, we spent a lot of time up in the mountains chasing cattle with my dad. And branding, that was one of those things where, we basically brand and do it the old way, and you'd rope the cattle and basically tie their feet with wire, and then you'd just hold them down while someone else would brand, and there were a couple times we got nicked with the brand, and ouch, that kind of hurt. those were fun times. And bringing in hay, that was another thing. One of the first times that I remember, we were bringing hay we were pulling hay, a walanya, which is basically a cart that has barandales, which are rails, where you basically use the pitchfork and pile on the hay, and then you'd have a big stack. And at the time, I didn't know I was allergic to. All I was doing was sneezing, and so I'd leave with my eyes all bugged out because of allergic reactions. But those were good times. And one of the things with this is the irrigating our lands. I want to stress here that this is very important, a tradition that we need to keep up to protect protect everything that we have that was granted to us through the Guadalupe, the Hidalgo Treaty. That's very important that we keep those traditions alive. By keeping those traditions alive, it ensures that our treaty is respected and it continues to move on. So that's just something I wanted to bring to everyone's attention. Now, moving on, we have a cousin, Domicino Onesimo, Manuelita. She was, she moved to Colorado. She had a sister, Virginia, Rosana, Selena, Ninfa, Abran, and Federico. I'd like to share more, but I don't know very much about our aunts and uncles. Now, Manuel de Atocha, he had a brother who is, before I move on to his brother, he was also married to Nieves, and I don't know her last name. But from that marriage, we had an uncle, Jose Maestas, who lived next across the street from where we live up in Rodarte, next to my Tio Frumencio and Tia Lisa. And they had another son, Virgilio and Manuel. Now, one of the things that I found interesting is during the 1860s, that time frame, the name Maestas was introduced. We were a territory at that time, and we were now, the census was being done. So, as you notice, his father, Jose Lorenzo de Jesus Maestas, is spelled differently. The A is no longer there. And so that tie I found within Betty Pacheco's research and collection of baptisms and marriages from Picuris. So that if there's any name changes that occurred, that's one area that you can look for, one area that you might be able to find ties. I certainly did. Now, I might mention that there's a mystery right now whether we're related to Gloria Maestas, who's also has helped bring together the culturas. And so one of the things that we will probably look into is it could be that this Juan de Jesus Maestas may have been one of her great-great-grandfathers. There is a Juan Maestas, but don't know, we still have to verify that. So that's, she did, there were a couple of names on here, Maria Ofelia, Maria Manuela, Maria Juana. That seems to be a possible tie, along with Maria Marcelina. And so he was married to Maria Viviana Martin, which is also Martinez. And as you can see, the Martin name also lived. It later got changed in the territorial days to Martinez. His father for Jose Lorenzo was Jose Manuel Maestas, and he was married to one of the rivales. So there's another tie to potentially the same rivals from here in Peñasco. Their siblings are Maria Rafaela, Jose, Juan Dolores de Jesus, Maria Eusebia, and Victoriano, and Francisco. Now, if memory serves me correct, Victoriano Maestas, I believe he was adopted by, excuse me, I am going in the wrong direction. Their fathers were Cristobal Clemente Maestas. Now, Cristobal Clemente Maestas was one of the original grantors with Valentin Martin, I believe. I believe it was Martin. And they were the original grantors for the Santa Barbara land grant, along with 67 others. The now this this son, who is Victoriano Mestas, it's my understanding that he was adopted, and he was the child of an Apache couple, and so they took him in as their own. They were one of the, they were very, well, all of our families were very ingrained with the Catholic religion, so it was just one of, they intermingled with the native population, the Indians here. And so Victoriano was Apache. Now, now Cristobal and his wife Uralia Gonzalez, they came here in 1796 as the grantors. Okay. Now, before that, it's my understanding that before coming here, that our ancestors for the Mestas were basically living out of San Juan de los Caballeros, which is now, it used to be San Juan, slightly north of Española, which is now Unuanque or something like that. Uinque, yeah. So that's the original settlement where in 1598, as we settled New Mexico, that was the first settlement that we came to, and then eventually migrated to Las Trampas, to Santa Cruz de la Cañada, Embudo, and Taos and Mora, and from there the tree just grew. Now his father, he had brothers Hilario, Francisca, Aparicio, and Asensio. His father was Cristobal Mestas, married to Juana Josefa Archuleta. And moving on to Mateo. Mateo also was from San Juan de los Caballeros. And he was married to Rafaelita Cortez. Now, it's my understanding that he was also during the U.S. independence from Britain in the war in 1776, he was fighting for Spain on behalf of Spain for America's interest. And part of that, it's there's an organization that basically they call it there's an organization that basically ties in, you know, from a 1776 of all of the dissent, you know, their support to the United States at that time. Now, looking at moving on to his father and mother, their father was Juan de Mestas Peralta and Casilda López Osuna. Now, Juan Mestas de Peralta, don't know what happened. It appears that his father won them Estas, the original Mestas that arrived in Santa Fe. His father died at an early age. But now looking at Juan de Mestas, when he arrived in 1657, along with his friend and countryman, Paisano, Amigo y Paisano, as he was introduced, he arrived with his friend, Governor Manso. I guess they were friends back in Asturias, Spain. And it turns out that he lived there in the palace of the governor and was basically was a merchant. And so he kept his merchandise there in the palace of the governor. There was a situation where one of the native Indians that were basically serving the Spanish, because they were slaves, one of them stole some merchandise. And so they looked around and they figured out who it was. But it was just one of those unfortunate things that happened. But in terms of Juan de Mestas, he's basically the roots of our history here in New Mexico. One of the things that I did find out, and it's still something that needs to be confirmed, is he possibly may have came from Belgium. So that's a possibility. So, as such, I conclude my presentation and want to thank everyone on the celebration, the Culturas, and I want to thank each and every one of you for taking interest in our history, our legacy, and I encourage you to all continue to participate, to grow, and expand this very positive energy, because I think sometimes we see a lot of negative things going on in the community, and the only way that I see that negative energy can dissipate and go on its way to leave is if we have more of these events to where we strengthen our community roots, because we have a very proud history that we need to continue to nourish and cultivate. And it's very important, it ties in with our ownership to community land grants, our ownership to our acequias, and our ownership to our water rights. Those were granted to us through the Guadalupe, the Hidalgo Treaty, and we must not let that be lost. Very important. So thank you.